But we're kidding around. All right, so English language learners in St. Paul, Minnesota. What's going on, Chris?
Yeah, so there's a fun fact here. One third of the approximately 39,000 students in the St. Paul district are English language learners.
Huh.
Pretty large number, right?
I wouldn't have guessed it's that high, yeah.
Yeah, according to this report, it's
largely... You're not talking about El Paso, Texas, or Tucson, Arizona.
St. Paul.
Or you're talking about Minnesota, right. So, okay, go ahead.
Largely due to an influx of Karen refugees from the country of Burma or Myanmar, war-torn country in Asia. But
no kidding, all right.
The district is pushing to get English learners into high school mainstream classes that actually teach English rather than keeping them in the
bilingual
classes.
Uh-huh. Right. All right. And this, of course, a big controversy, and we don't talk enough about it. And so I did think it was interesting. And I guess you're saying the point of the story is that in St. Paul they're doubling down on English immersion.
Right.
Okay. So Greg Lawson, this is kind of the zig instead of the zag, or if I probably screw that up. This is like the salmon swimming upstream, if I can mix my metaphors. This is not in the vanguard normally of how English language learning is happening in most places. In most places, bilingual education is the politically correct answer to this, not English immersion. So in St. Paul, they're saying, let's do it a different way. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, I think it'd be interesting to run the experiment. I mean, here's the problem. We oftentimes worry so much about what is politically acceptable in our speech that we don't deal with what is actually to the benefit of individuals. And the most important thing is, will it work? Will it improve things? Will it improve, you know, graduation rates? Will it improve academic outcomes? I guess until you've run the experiment, you can't know that. And so it's interesting to see somebody trying to do something with a different population. And that's actually an interesting area because Minneapolis, right next door, I guess, to St. Paul, has the largest Somali population in the country.
The largest Somali population.
Yes. Okay. Columbus, Ohio, where I actually am, the Buckeye Institute, actually has the second largest Somali population in the country, interestingly enough.
Who would guess that the Somalians would be looking at, like, huh, I'm looking at America, let's say Columbus. We're going to go there. Go Minneapolis, yeah. Columbus, check. That's pretty
you
much
wouldn't
it.
Think that. Yeah, Minneapolis, right, yeah. Columbus are probably, you know, it's not New York or California or something, so it's an interesting dynamic. But, you know, let's see what happens. Here's the bottom line. Do we want people to be able to be successful? We want to be sure that people are learning. We want to be sure that we can move folks into a position to where they can be successful later in life. And why do we need such rigid ideological straitjackets to be put on ourselves to the point where we say, oh, no, you can't even consider that. You can't even have that as an idea in your head because, of course, that's politically incorrect.
No.
Don't we care what happens to people?
No, there have been lots of studies, though, but I do think that there is a political correctness with respect to bilingual ed that's... At Choice Media, we need to do more of this. We really
have... There's a good quote in the story, actually. It's from... it says, "We forget the resilience of these students we bring into our classrooms." So this is from the assistant superintendent. It says, "Are we going to build on their resilience, or are we going to hug them until we almost stifle them?"
I see. Meaning that in a way, bilingual is a form of coddling, almost. Mm-hmm. Like, all right. Let's move on. Let's talk.
And these are folks that have come in from very tough situations. You know, the Somali communities did. The communities that you mentioned there. It's an interesting quote that you have because there's a reason folks do come to America. It's because they recognize what the opportunities are, and it's incumbent, I think, to give them the best. To take advantage of those opportunities, sure, and not take away some of the tools that can be most advantageous to them.
Well, let's face it. A lot of, I think, this is driven by the fact that normally when you just bring up this issue of bilingual education, you're talking about Spanish-speaking kids. So
right.
I think when you introduce these other populations of kids that don't speak English, they may not have the bilingual ed program where they're prepared to teach, you know, high school science in whatever Somali dialect these kids are coming in. So by default, they end up being English language immersion, and they may end up doing better than the Spanish-speaking kids who are given bilingual ed in their native tongue.